This is your life. This, the National Theatre, one of the great showcases in the world of the theatrical arts. An unlikely place, you might think, to come looking for the favourite tough guy of millions from a very popular television series. But he also happens to be a great man of the theatre, which is why he's in here right now discussing a part he's about to play in a play here in this theatre. Now, the foyer here, the piano music, has become very much a part of the pre-curtain-up scene, although hardly all at one time collecting such a distinguished audience as now. Actors whose names are bywords in the country, director, producer, writer, and an actress of great distinction who just happens to be the wife of the man whose meeting inside should be finishing just now, and whose reactions, I assure you, are entirely unpredictable when he passes by here and faces the music. That's when I'll move, when he comes, and after that, who knows what'll happen. Thank you, Sheila, and your famous pals. John Burgess, thank you. I know the subject was Sergeant Musgrave's dance, but we have another production in mind because tonight, John Thaw, this is your life.
Bravo. What are you doing in the place like this, John?
Well, I know you're due on stage here, not very far in the future, but a bit sooner where
yes,
we want to take you.
A very good start.
Across the river to our theatre in the West End, where
thank
it's all
you,
set
John.
To go.
Don't ever sing
You've never heard such bad singing in your life, but we were waiting for you.
I can see the singers.
Very nice.
All right, we head for the theatre. Well, John, an unscheduled production of the National Theatre there.
Yes, very unscheduled. Yeah, I thought I was going to meet all the cast of Musgrave's dance.
Well, in fact, you're going to meet our cast who were there, all of whom at one time or another have shared a corner of your life. The man you were with at that meeting just now, National Theatre director John Burgess. Creator and writer of The Sweeney, Ian Kennedy Martin.
Hello.
Producer Ted Childs. And those famous stars, Diane Keane, Carol Drinkwater, Jack Smethurst, James Ellis, Kenny Lynch, John Bluthall, Tony Selby. George Sewell, Ian Hendry, and last but not least, our leading lady, and a very distinguished one at that, now associate director with the Cambridge Theatre Company, your wife, Sheila Hancock. Well, Sheila, it was your turn to keep the secret this time.
I know, I'm exhausted with it. I was terrified he was going to say no, I have to tell you. But still, he did it to me a few years ago, so it serves him right.
It does. And John Thaw, this is your life. And three young ladies very close to you have been keeping very quiet about a secret rendezvous they had with a great pal of yours. An appointment which took them to the present location of a vastly popular television series. You recognize, I'm sure, your daughters, Melanie, Abigail, and Joanna. Suspense is killing me.
It is.
Hello, Dad. Remember when you were on Sweeney and had to do all those fight scenes?
You took lessons and became very good at the art of self-defense.
And he thought it'd be a very good idea if you taught us three how to look after ourselves.
Oh, great. That sounds like Dennis. Come on, he's expecting us.
Hello, Eamonn. Hello, John, my son.
Gotcha.
It's a normal location for a new series of mine, and, well, there are a few bits and pieces that we're used to doing the Sweeney that are very handy in this series. No, I mean, you weren't bad, John. I mean, it's all right. I mean, you know, chicken after all. But, I mean, if you really wanted to teach the girls how to look after themselves, I mean, you should have swallowed your pride and come straight to me. I mean, you know it's true. So, come on, girls. I'll show you a few things the old man hasn't even dreamed of. Come here. Right, hold on.
Why?
Now, listen, what did the old man say you should do if somebody grabs you from behind, for instance?
Right.
I'll give in. Thank goodness you're my friend, Joanna.
It's a wrap!
And here they are, Melanie, Abigail, and Joanna. And Joanna, tell us, how was Uncle Dennis after that lesson he gave you?
I think he's recovering now.
I think he just about is, because he's here too. Your old pal from the Sweeney, Dennis Waterman. Well, John Thaw, this is your life, and the award-winning actor-to-be was born on January the 3rd, 1942, far from the West End, in fact, in West Gorton, Manchester, at number 48 Stowell Street. Now, sadly, your parents' marriage didn't work out, and at five, you move with your brother and dad to Daneham Road, Burnage, Manchester, where a regular treat for the young John Thaw was a visit to the Saturday morning cinema club at the local Odeon to see old screen stars like Roy Rogers, Flash Gordon, and Hopalong Cassidy.
But there was another star as well who was a big favourite with all the kids.
From their home in Stockport, with your stepmother Mildred, your father John. John, apart from the film stars you mentioned, who was this favourite star with the kids?
John, because he used to go on the Saturday morning matinees, and during the interval, he used to get on the stage, do a few gags, a few impersonations, and he got that good that him and Ray used to get him free every Saturday morning.
Dennis Waterman, even years later, John here hadn't forgotten his old make-em-laugh routine from childhood, had he?
Yes.
No, I've remembered a few. Because I did the same at my dramas. I mean, many years later, of course. But no, we. There were times when we had to use it in the Sweeney. If I may just say that, and I speak on behalf of the whole unit and everybody who worked on the Sweeney, we did four really, really happy years, largely due to this gentleman. But. Nevertheless, we did sing and dance together now and again, even in the places when we didn't tell our wives.
But on the Sweeney, we know you did, because we remember a scene when you entertained some visiting foreign police officers with a great snozzle Durante number, The Song Has Gotta Come From the Heart. Take it away.
Up haskins if the song goes down.
well as getting up on the stage of that Saturday morning cinema club, we've been hearing that in those boyhood days you were also a star of radio. And we're going back to Stowell Street, where you were born, to number 82, still the home of your Auntie Beatty and your Uncle Charlie.
Hello, John. This is your Uncle Charlie, broadcasting to you on Radio Stowell Street, where you, John, made your very first broadcast when you was only 8 years old. And me and your...
Oh, shut up, Charlie. What a treat to switch him off. Hello, John, love. Do you remember when Uncle Charlie was working on a subcontract for the BBC? And when he came home, he'd brought you an old-fashioned microphone. And he rigged it all up for you. Auntie Doris, Auntie Mary, Uncle Harold were all listening to you and really enjoying it. Let's get up and go and have a look where Uncle Charlie is now, shall we? I bet he's in your old broadcasting studio.
And we've got some famous personalities calling into this studio soon. Hello, John. Remember this studio where you used to broadcast from? And now back to Eamonn Andrews and the London studios.
But only for a moment so that I can say they're here. Your Uncle Charlie and Auntie Petey, and Uncle Harold and Auntie Mary, and Auntie Dolly. While school is at Ducey Technical High School, where you're a natural for the school's drama society, and in one performance of Macbeth, you particularly distinguish yourself.
I'll say you did, John. You actually rewrote Shakespeare yourself.
History master and drama producer, you haven't seen him for 20 years, John Lee, and with him your former headmaster, Sam Hughes. John, tell me, how did your star drama pupil here come to rewrite the Bard?
Well, you see, one of the cast forgot his cue, and John was left on the stage to improvise Shakespeare blank verse, which he did very well. Not half as good as a blank verse afterwards, though.
And where was the missing member of the cast?
On the loo.
Sam Hughes, yes. You were very impressed by John's talents, weren't you?
Yes. Yes, I advised him to go on to become a professional actor, but this, of course, meant training, it meant RADA, it meant getting grants, and here there were difficulties. John was 2 years too young and about four or five subjects in GCE too light. And but we rallied friends, packed the committee, and in the end, we got the grant. A bit of manipulation, but I think in the end, justified.
And I shall always be very, very eternally grateful to you, Mr. Hughes.
Thank you, Sam Hughes and John Lee. John, I wonder if you remember setting off for your audition at RAD. It was in your Uncle Charlie's van, wasn't it?
That's right, yeah, the old little Ford van, yeah.
Oh, it was a very eventful family trip in that van 20 years ago. Charlie, what happened to your old van?
It's not an old van. Do you mind, Eamonn? It's my dad still uses it. Still uses
it. And to prove it, there it is, John, the van. The van that brought you to London on the journey that changed the course of your life. Well, you're offered a place at RADA. Do you remember your feelings that day? You were only 16.
Yeah, well, I was obviously delighted. I mean, I was.
And when he got the offer, Dad, you helped him, I take it, to pack his suitcase.
Suitcase? Couldn't afford a suitcase. I wrapped it up in a brown paper parcel. That's our suitcase. Yes.
Well, with that brown paper parcel under your arm, you say goodbye to Manchester. You're off to seek fame and fortune in the big city. Now, at RADA, as well as classes for acting, there are also singing classes. And one day, 23 years ago, you're passing the glass panel door of one of the classrooms and see one student being put through his musical paces.
Who is Sylvia? What is she?
Yes, indeed. That student pal today, international stage and screen star, you instantly recognize Tom Courtney.
Who is Sylvia?
Tom, in those days, you shared digs, of course, with John.
Yes, sir. We had a flat in Highbury Crescent.
But it was nice of him to take an interest in your singing that day.
Yes, we see, unbeknown to any of us, the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art was planning a big musical for the following term. And it was set in the East End, and the leading part was would have suited John wonderfully. You see, it was the leader of a gang of teddy boys. But you see, being, as he was in those days, a bit of a hard case, he said, oh, I'm going to learn to sing a song. And I did my Who Is Sylvia, and as a result, I got the best part. And John, poor John, had to make do with what Paradise Lost you were in.
Yes. Thank you, Tom Courtney. Well, after 2 years at Rada, John, you get your first job at Liverpool Rep. Just over a year later, you get a chance to appear on television in a role close to your heart, as you'll hear from a great pal from those days. Now in Coronation Street, there's Mike Baldwin's famous Red Jag, and at the wheel, the actor who plays that character, need hardly tell you, it's Johnny Briggs.
Hello, Eamonn, and hello, John. Now, though I'm talking to you from the Coronation Street set, just thinking about you, John, has made me take a trip down memory lane. Do you know it's 20 years since we first worked together, you and I, up here in the Granada Television Studios in Manchester? It was a series called The Younger Generation. And I seem to remember, at that particular time, you had a pretty good line going in teddy boy parts. Do you remember? The DA, drain pipe trousers, and the thick suede shoes. The first play that we did together up here was called The Mating Game. You looked after me, showed me around. Good luck at the National Theatre, mate. In the meantime, have a superb night tonight. Oh, and I've taken the opportunity of lining one up and drinking your health. Bert?
There you are, my
love. Thank you, darling.
Oh, yes, Dad.
Thank you. Cheers, mate.
Cheers, love. Happy night.
Thank you, Betty Driver and Johnny Briggs, up there in Coronation Street. More West End appearances follow. In December 1961, you appear in The Fireraisers at the Royal Court, and the following year at the Arts, and in Semi-Detached at the Savile Theatre. Television producers, too, are impressed by your talent, and in 1964, you get your own series playing Sergeant Mann, the tough investigating officer of the Army's own police in Red Cap. And here you are, questioning barman Jack Smethurst about some hijinks in the officer's mess.
Cavalry dress officers for the use of. Did you have a guest here last night?
No. It walked on its own, that.
Spare me your humour, just answer my question.
You take that as
a... Did the army officer come in here last night?
And what if he did?
Yes or no?
Yes.
Why?
Well, I expect it was out of the company.
Must have been.
Jack, you tell me that was a memorable series with John.
I can't remember, Eamonn. No, actually, it was a memorable night as well, because John, apart from being a fine actor and a great guy, is also, well, is a soul of generosity. And after that show, which was the last one of that series of Red Cap, John threw a marvellous party for us all paid for, all the booze and everything was paid for. I don't know how much it cost him, but I took the empties back, got a few bob. And John has been doing the Sweeney ever since, I paid for it. So I believe.
Well, after Red Cap was paid off, you appear as a detective in the popular TV series Z Cars with James Ellis there, and in 1968 make the feature film The Beaufort's Gun. And you meet Sheila when you're cast together in a new West End play in 1969, a play, Sheila, with what proved later an appropriate title.
Yes, it was called So What About Love? I've been saying that ever since over the washing up.
A few years later, there was a happy real-life ending.
Yes, we got married on Christmas Eve, and I was appearing in a show that night, so we thought we'd keep it quiet. But we didn't realise that the Cirencester Registry Office was right opposite the local paper, so on the way driving back, it was announced on the news that we'd got married. And when we got there, the party had there was a wonderful party arranged by the cast. It was lovely.
And Joanna, these days your dad has quite a lot of ladies to look after him at home, hasn't he?
Yes, even the cat.
Even the cat? So the cat's a lady too, girls. How does your father react to all this feminine company?
Surrounded by women, help me!
But But despite all the ladies around, I've been hearing, John, that you sometimes like to take over the cooking at home, especially when you have a barbecue.
Yes, indeed, John. Your barbecues are definitely major productions.
And he knows all about the good life himself, your neighbour and good friend, stage and television star, Richard Briers. So, young John, here's a dab hand of the garden barbecue.
Well, not many people know that. I mean, he's a fantastic actor, and he's such fun to be with as a person, but he's a remarkably fine cook, particularly in outdoor cooking and barbecue. In fact, I was with him the night he actually bought the new barbecue, and it was outside, of course, and torrential rain. And John is a very determined man. You have to be in this rotten business of ours. Very determined and a great courage. And he was trying everything to make this thing light. We tried paraffin, we tried petrol, we tried gin. And in the end, being a physical coward myself, for John certainly isn't a very brave man. And he was slaving away. I was in the doorway, out of the rain, holding the gin. And after about 2.5 hours, he actually managed to get it light. That is determination. We had 2 pounds of very fine pork sausages. And I can assure you here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, if you've never tasted John Thaw's pork sausages in paraffin sauce, you have not lived, believe me, a treat in store. It was a wonderful night, John. Always a great pleasure to see you.
Thank you, Richard Briers. Well, John, in 1974 you helped cook up something which really sets the television screen alight with the part of Detective Inspector Jack Regan of The Sweeney. And not only on television, but in a feature film with Diane Keane, who's here tonight, as you know. Diane, Inspector Regan came to question you, didn't he?
Yes, he did, but I didn't know he was going to do it in the shower. Kept that very quiet. Apart from beating me up, it was quite a pleasant experience.
Well, John, so many good friends here tonight, including, of course, Tom Courtney, as I said, student with you at RADA, but there was another student pal in those days, 25 years ago, someone who can't be here tonight because he's due on stage in New York, where he's just opened to rave notices. From Broadway now, your great pal, Nicole Williamson.
Well, John, this must be a very great thrill for you, and one which is well-deserved. We've known each other for many years, and I, amongst many other people, am a great admirer of your work, and naturally, of course, I value your friendship. I hope that the future holds at least as much and as many good things as the past. Have a good time.
Thank you, Nicole Williamson in New York. And before we close, John, I'd like to remind you of some rave reviews you earned yourself right here in London in the West End hit of 1979 for your portrayal of a tough Australian newspaper man in the award-winning Night and Day. To share the stage with you again tonight, your distinguished leading lady from that play, that great international star, Diana Rigg. Diana, you and John opened in that play at Wimbledon. Any first night nerves?
Well, not only did we have first night nerves, we had first night catastrophe. Do you remember the revolve went round the wrong way? Oh. Terrible sound of splintering furniture. We had a little boy in the cast. He came on and he got his lines all wrong, right? And then I tried to save the day and I wasn't familiar enough with the script and I fed you a line, which was 5 pages later. And then you and I looked at each other and we just started to laugh. It was just absolutely helpless. And then the audience started to laugh, thank God. And they got the joke and we went back to the beginning and started again. I really am here to say that during 8 months you get to know somebody terribly well. And I think you're a marvellous actor, but more important than that, I think you're a very, very dear man.
Thank you, Diana Rigg. Well, John, it's 22 years since you and your dad clambered aboard your Uncle Charlie's van for the drive through the night to what must have seemed a hopeless quest for a youngster with one O-level, a coveted place at RADA.
And if one little heart wasn't beating faster than yours, John, on that journey, it was mine.
He was in that van with you. He went to live in Australia 15 years ago, so he's had to make a slightly longer journey tonight. We've flown him 10,000 miles from Brisbane, your only brother, Raymond. Raymond, you were just 14. Any special memory of the journey on that van that day?
I can remember there was a great deal of excitement, and I wasn't quite aware at the time what was really going on, but as we can all see here tonight, it's turned out a very good trip.
Good on you, sport.
And I'm very proud to be here.
John Thaw, this is your life.